it wasn't like any other music that was playing at that time.
It was very much the birth of Virgin.
I was a sort of a session man at the time with an artist called Arthur Louis, who just happened to be rehearsing at the Manor. And I gave copies of my demo tapes to two of the engineers there, Tom Newman and Simon Hayworth.
He came and poked his nose right here and said, "Listen to this." And I listened to it to maybe a day or two later. He kept pestering me, and it was just absolutely beautiful. And Richard listened to it and he loved it, but there was no infrastructure of record label yet.
And then when I left, you know, they liked the demos, they promised to get back to me. So I waited and I waited and I waited and waited. And a year later, after going around to all the other record companies and being rejected, finally got a call from Simon Draper, which was Richard's partner, to come and have dinner with them on Richard's barge.
I remember hearing the tape and just thinking it was hauntingly gorgeous. And we just thought, well, you know, maybe we should try to, you know, start a record company, literally just to put out Tubular Bells. The manor was a beautiful old manor house, which, you know, we managed to get for, I don't know, £20,000. People could, you know, live there. They could record all night, which most people wanted to record all night. Mike would record in between other artists coming to the manor. Because he was living there, he had quite a lot of time to record. Out of this introverted young lad came this beautiful, beautiful music.
The Tubular Bells was an accident, because when I finally got to the manor, they were wheeling a set out from the musician who was there before me. And as they were going past, I suddenly thought, hey, I might be able to use those. Can you bring them back in? So they went, going again.
Making the record, once we decided to do it and Michael had focused, was relatively easy. But this poor bugger had the worst job in the world, because he had to sell it. It wasn't like any other music that was playing at that time.
You know, having to try to get out and promote it with Mike not wanting to do any interviews at all.
Well, I did one. It was awful.
What, Melody Maker?
He asked me, "Why did you write Tubular Bells?" I thought for about 20 minutes. He was getting really upset and angry, you know, kind of impatient. Because I wanted to give him an honest answer. And in the end, I just couldn't come up with it. I don't know why, you know. It's like I didn't do it for a reason. It just kind of happened. And then after that, you know, I think, that was horrible, I'm not doing any more of these, you know?
We had John Peel to the boat, we played in the whole album, he was captivated by it.
Anything he played, everybody would say, all right, well, this is important, we're going to listen to it. When he played the entire album, used his whole show, I remember sitting in the kitchen of the manor, you know, and just this little radio, and I just couldn't believe it.
No, it was a wonderful moment. We went and saw Stevie Winwood and at his home in Oxford, and Mick Taylor, and they all agreed to come and play at the Queen Elizabeth Hall. On the way there, Mike got a panic attack and just said, I'm not going to go through with it. You don't mind me telling you a story? I've told you before. So I thought, how do I get him over this panic attack? Because there was a lot resting on this concert, and in fact it could have been, you know, make or break for Mike, make or break for Virgin. It was pretty important. Anyway, I'd been given an old Bentley for my wedding, and I just said to Mike, look, I know that you psychologically can't do the concert, and I pulled out the key of the Bentley. If you do the concert, and I give you the key after the concert, do you think you could overcome your psychological traumas at the moment? Anyway, he paused for a few moments.
And I thought, all right then.
He overcame the psychological trauma. And thank God he did, because the concert was, you know, it had standing ovations. And
I don't think I've ever heard a cheer of applause so loud as on that night, and I couldn't understand it, that I felt that we'd done it so badly. But to my astonishment, they absolutely loved it. And then this movie called The Exorcist came out, and the theme, it became the theme tune from The Exorcist. And because of The Exorcist, it got propelled, you know, worldwide to, you know, the top of the charts, and it stayed there for ages and ages. Got this phone call from Danny Boyle, and he asked if I would be agreeable to coming in and performing at the opening ceremony of the London Olympic Games. And I didn't even have to think about it. I said, yes.
Incredibly well deserved, and a magical day. Question that us meeting on the boat that night, you know, transformed both our lives, and it was very much the birth of Virgin. He doesn't lose it, does he?